House Media.
A quick warning before we begin. This episode will contain the names of people and places that are entirely fictional, which I'm sure to mispronounce often. I hope you'll find it in your heart to forgive me. Enjoy the show.
Between the years when the oceans drank Atlantis and the rise of the sons of Arius, there was an age undreamed of, when shining kingdoms lay spread across the world. Hither came Conan, the Cimmerian, sword in hand. It is I, his chronicler, who knows well his saga. Now let me tell you of the days of high adventure.
From Steeven or Else Media, this is Hither Came Conan, treading the jeweled thrones of Hyperborea beneath its sneakered feet, one comic book at a time. I'm your host, my name is Steeven, and I have no idea what to say. Not at all. See, when I am preparing for these episodes and I'm writing out what I'm going to say here during this intro bit, if nothing comes to me, you know, right away, as I'm writing, I will just put in a placeholder in the notes that says something like, I have no idea what to say. So yeah, the fact that at this moment, here on this episode, the fact that I'm explaining to you what I put in the notes when a bit of that writer's block hits me, well, that means I never did come up with anything. Well, I mean, except to say that today we're looking at Conan number 6 from Dark Horse Comics. Okay, so I'm sorry, but I needed to break in here because I feel like I always have to explain stuff. It's a me thing. It's not a you thing. But last week at the end of the show, I said that we would be talking about Conan the Barbarian number 9 from Titan Comics this week, seeing as the issue just hit the stands this last Wednesday on March the 27th. But yeah, we're not going to do that. And again, I can't help but over-explain my decisions in these matters. It's my neurodivergent brain that forces me to do these things, and I promise that I will do my very best to be as brief and concise as possible. But I haven't been feeling well all week long, and since I had this episode talking about Conan number 6 already done and in the can, I just figured I'd skip the Titan book this week. But here's the thing. I told myself at some point during the previous arc of this Titan run, that when the next arc began, I was going to start waiting until each arc ended before I started releasing episodes. Mainly because for a while there, the issues kept coming out late and it was messing with my schedule. Well, Conan the Barbarian, issue number 9, is the beginning of the third arc. And I've read it twice already, and it is so good. So good. So good. I just didn't get time to get the episode ready because, again, I haven't really been feeling all that well. So, yeah, I figured at this point I would take that as a sign. And while I may be recording episodes talking about each issue of this third arc of the Titan run, I'm going to save them up and release them weekly once the arc is completed. And I'm going to try real hard not to feel weird about that because, well, because it means that I'm always going to be an arc behind on the show, but you know what? That's okay. Hither Came Conan has never been about brand new stuff. Not really. So again, I'm not going to feel weird or guilty or like I'm missing out by not putting these Titan episodes out the same week that the issues were released. Each arc so far has been 4 issues long. So the third arc should be issues 9 through 12. And so the week that issue 13 hits the stands, we'll be talking about issue number 9 here on Hither Came Conan. And then the next 3 episodes after that will be issues 10, 11, and 12. Anyway, like I said, my brain forces me to explain this stuff because, you know, the thought of anyone listening to this episode and going, wait, Conan number 6? But last week you said we'd be looking at the new Titan book this week. What the hell, man? Well, it makes me feel such heavy guilt that I'm not doing what I said I was going to do. And I mean, I've already been sick all week. I don't need that guilt to add to it. But again, it's my thing. It's me. It's not you. That means I never did come up with anything. Well, I mean, except to say that today we're looking at Conan number 6 from Dark Horse Comics. This issue hit the stands on Wednesday, July 28th, 2004. It sports a cover date of $2.99, and it is entitled Day of Farewell. It was written by Kurt Busiek with art by Cary Nord and Thomas Yates, letters by Richard Starkings and Comicraft, and the colors were by Dave Stewart.
Into the boat!
Previously in Conan number 5. Still enslaved by the lanky, gaunt, and immortal Hyperboreans, Conan's plan for escape goes awry when he learns that Iasmini's master, Lord Ashtiana, plans to commit ritual suicide, taking Iasmini and all his other slaves with him. This forces Conan to move up his timetable, and so he takes the rest of Iasmini's special leaf to use in pulling his icer pals out from under the spell of the Yellow Lotus. It works, and by the next morning, Conan is leading a revolt against their captors. As issue 6 opens, the slave revolt is in full swing and Conan is front and center, rallying his icer friends and urging them onwards.
What will you do without freedom?
Everything seems to be going right for Conan and the crew. Though the newly awakened slaves are groggy with heads full of cobwebs, the narrow streets provide them with the advantage in the fight, as the Hyperborean force cannot attack at once. Plus, as Niord points out, the Hyperboreans have grown too used to hiding behind their walls, and that a full assault from within is something that they are so not prepared to deal with. It's then that Conan realizes that he doesn't see Iasmini anywhere. The plan, he recalls, was for Iasmini, once it starts, once she hears the commotion, to slip away and meet him at the Dolphin Stair, a set of steps named for the stone dolphins that sit atop pedestals to either side of the stair. As the barbarian's memory goes back to that evening when the two of them were discussing the plan, when they were both in bed and both naked, he suddenly snapped back into the present, desperate to find his lady love. Njord urges him to go, to find her, assuring Conan that he and his warriors have everything well in hand. And so the Cimmerian takes off, soon finding himself alone at the foot of the Dolphin Stair. No Iasmini anywhere.
Speaking rhymes all the time.
Fearing that she was not able to get away, Conan sets off to find her. While he vowed not to leave Hyperborea without his icer friends, he would also not leave the girl behind either. Meanwhile, as the men of Asgard advance further, fighting their way to the gates, the Undermages arrive, each holding a glowing jewel in their hands. Conan, still climbing the long and winding dolphin stairs, suddenly finds himself high above the battle, and he watches in horror as below, the Undermages, firing beams of light from their magic jewels, take out the men of Asgard, dropping them to the stone street like sacks of potatoes. The Cimmerian has no time to intervene, however, when a pair of guards coming down the Dolphin Stair discover him. Conan slices open the first guard, and as the dead man falls to the street below, he faces the charge of the second guard, who has the advantage of the high ground. Regardless, the guard only manages to run into Conan's sword, running himself through, and like his fellow guard, he topples dead from the stair onto the street far below. The problem for Conan is that the guard is still impaled on the barbarian's sword, and so when the guard falls, he takes Conan with him.
I've fallen, and I can't get up!
Sometime later, Conan wakes. He's dazed and groggy on the street below the Dolphin Stair. The two guards are there with him, but they're both dead, and Conan rises to a strangely familiar sound. Horns, which Conan suddenly realizes are blaring out the call to assembly for another day of farewell, specifically Lord Ashtiana's day of farewell, which means that Iasmini will be with him to jump to her death along with her master and the other slaves and members of Lord Ashtiana's house. Conan arrives as the procession is about to make their way onto the bridge.
The bridge of death.
Fighting his way through the crowd, Conan places himself between the procession and the drop-off, and he calls out to Ashtiana, telling the Hyperborean that if he doesn't let the others go, the barbarian's gonna, well,
Oh, do go on, please.
He doesn't quite get to finish his threat. His words sort of trail off as the procession continues to march forward until Ashtiana, oh so bored with the interruption to his big day, makes a slight gesture with his hand, and Conan, struck by a magic wind, is flung aside and then pressed into the stone street, unable to move, unable to do anything at all as the procession steps over and around him. Conan strains, trying as he might to rise, but he just simply cannot. Suddenly, Njord and the others are there, part of the procession, walking robotically by the barbarian, who can do nothing but watch. Soon, Iasmini passes him by as well, and like Njord and the others, she appears to be back under the influence of the Yellow Lotus. Watching helplessly as the girl walks away, Conan is struck by a horrifying realization. He knows now why Iasmini was not there to meet him at the Dolphin Stair. He had asked her for more of the leaf to administer to Njord and the others, to break them out from under the Lotus spell so that they could make their escape, and she had given him that leaf. And now Conan understands that it was the last of her leaf. She no longer had any defense against the Lotus herself. She had pinned everything on Conan, hoping against hope that she could hold out against the Lotus long enough for the Cimmerian to get her and take her to freedom. But Conan failed her, just as he fails her now. He can do nothing but watch as she steps off of the bridge and falls, disappearing from his sight. With her leap, Conan is, at last, able to rise. But it's too late. Lord Ashtiana, Njord, Iasmini, they were all gone. Conan steps up to the end of the bridge and looks down into the abyss below, his useless sword gripped tightly in one hand and a deep sorrow in his heart. A sorrow that quickly transforms into rage as Conan turns his back on the abyss to find a pair of guards and an undermage approaching. The mage orders the guards to take Conan alive so that they may experiment on him in order to discover how he was able to overcome the thrall of the Yellow Lotus. But, nah, Conan's not going to allow that.
Homie don't play that.
The barbarian, after cursing the Hyperboreans that Crom's fell grandchildren will devour their souls, allows himself to fall backward off of the bridge. Conan does not fall to his death, however, as a guard soon points out. The barbarian instead managed to grab hold of the bridge, and he has pulled himself over to the sheer face of the gorge where he has begun to climb down into the abyss. The Hyperboreans let him go, thinking that since the chasm is bottomless, the barbarian will eventually tire and fall. But Conan, as we know, is made of sterner stuff. He continues to climb down until eventually he finds that there is a bottom after all. On the floor of the chasm, Conan finds the bones of the Hyperboreans and their slaves, all who had taken the leap in the past. He also finds the body of Ashtiana, along with those of Njord and Iasmini. All from Lord Ashtiana's house are there, dead, their corpses being eaten by strange insects the size of large dogs. Conan chases the creatures away, and as he turns to tend to the bodies of his friends, finds Njord still breathing, but not yet long for the world. The Cimmerian tries to comfort his friend, who, with his last breath, asks Conan to do him one last favor. Conan, of course, agrees, and gathering the bodies of Njord and his fellow warriors, he piles them atop each other. And then, adding Iasmini to the pile, Conan sets them ablaze. The men of Asgard treat their dead differently than those of Cimmeria. While the Cimmerians bury their dead, the people of Asgard believe that it is only through fire that their spirits can reach Valhalla, that their souls travel the smoke that stretches into the heavens and takes them up to the halls of the dead. Conan hopes that, though Iasmini was not from the north, that the smoke will take her to Valhalla as well. Ashtiana, he leaves for the insects.
And I've shown him more mercy than he deserves.
Eventually, Conan equips himself from what the dead have left behind. With his armor, clothes, boots, even cape and sword, the Cimmerian is ready for his next move. And so, as the issue ends, Conan begins the long climb up and out of the chasm. He chooses, however, to make the climb on the side that will put him out opposite of Hyperborea. He has no desire to go back to Hyperborea. Not now, at least. Someday, he will return and he will make them pay. But for now, there are others he wants to see. Those who put all of this in motion. Two guys who, when Conan finds them, will surely die. Oh, my goodness. I don't know what to say about this one. This one was a hard one to read. And except for what they got going on over at Titan with the current Conan the Barbarian comic, I don't know that I have enjoyed an issue of a Conan comic as much as I enjoyed this one in a great, great long time. And yet, it was so sad. I mean, yeah, Conan survived, but he did not triumph in any way. This is a big, fat loss for Conan. And again, it's just sad. But I don't want to get into all that just yet. Not right here, because how this issue, this arc, the way it ends and what it means for Conan, well, that's going to be a part of
Steven's favorite bits.
All right, starting with the cover. This is another Joseph Michael Linzer cover. I don't know that I want to say that this might be my favorite of the six covers so far. As you know, some of them I didn't really care for. A couple of them I kind of liked. I really quite like this one. We have Conan. He's down at the bottom of the chasm. He's got dead bodies all around him. And behind him is like this spectral image of Iasmini. But in the foreground, we see a hand rising from the dead bodies. So I'm assuming that is the hand of Iasmini, who is dead. It's a very well put together cover. And thematically, I really like it. It makes me feel sad. And I really like that. Getting into the book right away, page one, splash page, title page, Conan, it's a close up of his face. He's screaming. He's got sweat and blood dripping off of him. You can see just a portion of the blade of his sword above his head, which has got blood all over it. And his blood is just dripping off of the blade. And he is screaming and encouraging the men of Asgard, you know, to kick some ass. And this, oh my God, this is such a good page. There have been so many great pages in these six issues. And this is just one of many perfect pages. I'm going to call it perfect. Conan, his mouth open, he's screaming. The way his eyes look, he looks like a dangerous fucker. I mean, he looks like somebody you just don't want to fuck with or even be around. I don't even know if you want to be friends with this guy, but if you are, you're going to thank the fucking gods every single night that this guy is your friend, because he is scary. And that's what this image portrays to me. Then we turn the page and we get into, I'm assuming it's a double page spread. Again, I'm reading this digitally. And based on how it looks on my screen, it looks like a double page spread. And the main portion of this double page spread looks pretty good. You've got Conan next to Njord, and they're fighting Hyperborean guardsmen, or at least slaves that have been captured by the Hyperboreans that are now acting as guardsmen. You've got more of the Icer warriors behind them fighting other guardsmen. It's a pretty decent portion of this two page spread. However, the smaller part, the second panel, again, good God almighty, it's almost a perfect panel. We'll start with Conan in the background. You don't see much of him, but again, he is screaming. He's urging his people on. He's urging them to advance and kill and kick some ass. But the main portion of this second panel, the foreground, is Njord. And he's got his sword in the air and just his eyes. He's got sweat dripping off of him. His hair is a bit disheveled because he's fighting. There's one lock of hair that's just hanging in front of his face, and he's smiling, but his eyes are like bugged out. Like, this is also a guy that you don't want to fuck with. So really, right away, if you consider this two-page spread as two pages, 3 pages into this freaking story, and I'm already practically being knocked out of my chair by just how fucking great the art looks. It looks gorgeous. And it's depicting some pretty exciting stuff as well. It's a great 3 pages. Hither Came Conan will return after these messages.
Are you tired of fanboy comics podcasts? Looking for a show that really appreciates the comic storytelling medium and how it works? A show that looks at comics from any genre and anywhere in the world, comparing the storytelling techniques of different creators in different comics cultures, with manga, newspaper strips, European comics, and more, discussed alongside mainstream US comics. A show that includes talks with well-known creators like James Robinson and Dan Jurgens, and with less famous creators that you really should know. And hey, we'll even critique your comic. If you're looking for that show, then you're looking for Deconstructing Comics, and it's right here at deconstructingcomics.com. Also available in iTunes and on Stitcher. This is Tim saying, check out our show on Wednesdays. That's Deconstructing Comics.
And now back to Hither Came Conan. Then we get to page 4, 5 panels. Panel number 1, Conan screaming, his eyes bulged out, spittle flying out of his mouth as Niord fights alongside of him. That is a great freaking panel. The next 3 panels are pretty good. 2 of them are Iasmini and Conan naked in bed discussing the plan. But then the 5th panel on this page, good God. It's like the previous pages. First, we get a incredibly great shot of Conan. Then we get an incredibly great shot of Niord. And we got the same thing here. Conan at the top of the page looks amazing and scary and almost true to life. And then Niord in the bottom panel, again, he's smiling, he's gritting his teeth, and his eyes are just bulging out. He looks like a freaking psycho. He looks like he is enjoying this way too much, and you really can't blame him. You can't look at him and go, all right, dude, you need to calm it down. You're enjoying this a little too much. Let's take a moment. Let's just take a beat here and breathe. No, you want to be right there next to him. Just go, man, go kill all these people. Yeah, you know, it's just this artwork, this storyline so far, these first few pages, it's just so visceral. I can feel it in my bones as I'm reading it. It's just so exciting and it looks great. Just these first few pages alone. The rest of the book, you could just throw it in the trash.
Wait, what?
Why would you say that?
What is wrong with you?
Boo!
Boo! Look, don't get me wrong. I'm not trying to say that the rest of the issue is shit. That's not what I'm trying to say. I know that's what it sounds like. I guess I'm trying to just emphasize how great those first few pages are, those first 5 pages. Like, if you were given this comic and all it had were those first 5 pages and you didn't know the rest of the story existed, you'd be okay with that. That's how great these first 5 pages are. The rest of the freaking issue is awesome as well. It's great. I don't want to insinuate that the rest of the issue is crap, and I failed miserably, and I don't know why I said it. I don't know why I said the thing that I said.
Well, that's because you're an idiot.
The rest of the issue is just as good as those first 5 pages. I apologize.
Apologies accepted.
We continue on and we still just keep getting more good shit. I don't want to stop and talk about every single page, but I do have to point out panel 3 of the next page, another close-up of Conan. He's off now looking for Iasmini, and he just got this look on his face like he's just so happy that he is doing something, that he's helping to free his friends. And you're going to keep hearing me say this, but it's a great panel. The next bit here where the undermages take out Niord and the Icer is just heartbreaking. You're up to that point, you are just full of adrenaline. You're just happy and you're everything's going great. They are finally getting free. They're going to kill all these fucking Hyperboreans and they're going to get out of there and they're going to live their lives and they're going to get back to their people. And then boom, they get taken out by 3 dudes in freaking robes shooting things out of giant jewels in their hands. And it just, I'm angry at this point. I'm angry and disappointed. And so when we see Conan watching this, who is also angry now, seeing this happen because he can't do anything about it. When these 2 guards come upon him, by the next page, when Conan just slices that first guard from his freaking throat to his crotch, it just slices him open. It's like, You get it. You understand. It's like you feel what Conan is feeling in this issue. You're taking this ride with him and you're going through these same emotions. Unfortunately, it's here that really kind of puts this exciting, this adrenaline rush, this mixture of emotions that are just knocking around inside my freaking head. This is where it just suddenly puts it all to an end. It just stops. It comes to a sudden stop because Conan and this guard falls off of, they fall off the stairs. They're like 100 or so feet up. They fall off the stairs and bam, everything goes black. Conan wakes up to realize that he's changed nothing. He started this revolution. They were going to get out. It was going to happen. But he wakes up to the sound of the horns and he realizes that he hasn't changed a thing. Lord Ashtiana is going to walk off at the end of that bridge and Iasmini is going to go with him. Well, Conan's not going to allow that to happen. So he arrives to try to put a stop to it, but he can't. And this page where he is on the ground and he can't get up and he's watching as Niord and the others and Iasmini passes him by and he realizes that there's nothing he can do. And then he realizes that Iasmini is in this position because he asked her to give him more of that leaf. So because he wasn't going to leave without the icer. You know, I think there's a moment here when he realizes that when he asked her for more leaf, she gave him everything she had left. And because of that, she had to try and fight the effects of the Yellow Lotus, hoping that Conan would rescue her before it was too late. And Conan's laying here on the ground, unable to move. He's helpless. He's watching her literally walk to her death. And I think there's a moment, they don't say it, but I think there's a moment where he realizes, I should have just taken her out of here that very first day. She and I could have left. She got me free from the Yellow Lotus. She was ready to go, but nope, I had to insist that we get Niord and the others out of here. And that was an honorable thing for him to do. But he's now realizing that because of this honorable decision that he made, not only did he not get Niord and his fellow Icer warriors out, now Iasmini's going to die as well. And that's what happens. They all walk off the end of the bridge. The moment where Conan jumps off the bridge and he's hanging there on the side of the chasm and he starts crawling down and the guard is like, should I get the mages and have them kill him? And This Hyperborean guy's like, don't worry about it. He's a bottomless chasm. He'll fall. He's going to die. Doesn't matter. That's just like one of those things that just seems to happen in a lot of movies. It's like the beginning of Star Wars Episode 4, A New Hope, when R2-D2 and C-3PO are escaping in the escape pod and they fly by the big Star Destroyer. And the one guy's like, hold your fire. There's no life forms aboard. And it's like, okay, that could have been a much different movie had you guys just said, we're just going to blow it up anyway, and you know, just for target practice.
Hold your fire. There's no life forms aboard.
Hold your fire? What are we, paying by the laser now?
You don't do the budget, Terry. I do.
And there's a lot of moments in movies like that. Let him go. He's not going to survive anyway. And then they survive and come back and make the bad guy realize that they made a big mistake. Of course, we don't see that in this issue. We don't know at this point, by the time this issue ends, if Conan does make it back to Hyperborea. They hint at it like he does, and I'll talk about it when we get there, but I'm not sure exactly how to interpret that passage, but we'll talk about it when we get to it. We're almost there. The bottom of the chasm, all the insects, all the dead bodies, creepy as hell. The bit with Niord, poor Niord, still alive. Conan immediately apologizes, tells him that he's sorry, that he failed him, and Niord doesn't blame Conan at all. It was the Hyperboreans that did this. Conan had nothing to do with this. Sure, he was the one that wanted to come to Hyperborea, but Niord wasn't going to go with him. This is not Conan's fault. Conan is feeling very guilty by this point. He's feeling like everything that's happened is his fault, and Niord tells him that no, it's not. And I don't think that Conan really takes that to heart. I don't think that Conan leaves at the end of the issue feeling okay about everything. It's not my fault. No, I think Conan's going to carry this with him for a while. I like the bit where he, you know, Niord asks him basically to gather up all the Asgardians, build a pyre, deal with their bodies the way their culture does, which is to
cremate them so that their souls can go to Valhalla. I feel like that was talked about in one of the earlier issues and I just failed to mention it. And now I can't remember which one it is. And I just don't have the strength to go back and look, but it's a very nice moment. And what's great about the page, it's a full splash page where Conan is standing before the fire and we see the smoke stretching up out of the chasm into this very small opening from our vantage point. It looks like this small little pinprick at the top almost. We see in the foreground in the corner the dead body of Ashtiana, and we get this bit of narration that says,
"The Hyperborean Lord's body he left for the creatures."
That is a great moment. That is a great moment. And then the ending, the last page, the look on Conan's face as he's climbing out of this chasm. He's very angry. He's ready to dish out a bit of retribution, but he's not going back to Hyperborea. He's going out on the other side. He's going to go find the two people who caused all this to happen. And I'm not going to talk about who those two people are. I think most of us know, but I want to leave a little mystery in case you don't know. But this is the moment where the narration basically says he's not going back to Hyperborea. It says,
"He could not make them pay, not yet, but in time he would."
So I don't know if that's the narrator telling us that, yes, there is a story in the future that Conan goes back to Hyperborea, maybe after he's a king and he leads the armies of Aquilonia to Hyperborea and crushes them. Or maybe it's the narrator saying that that's what Conan is saying in his head. "I can't make him pay right now. I can't. I'm just one guy. But one day I'm going to go back there and I will make them pay." So I don't know if that's actually, I feel like it's a bit of both. I think that there's some foreshadowing there, but I also think it's really what we are looking at are Conan's innermost hopes and dreams that he will one day go back and he will hand out a bit of justice to the people that did this. And that's how the issue ends. And this is the best of the six issues. It's really hard. The ending is just hard. It's hard to accept, you know, because though Conan lived, he failed. This was a big failure for Conan. Sure, he's free. He's back to tread the jeweled thrones of the earth beneath his sandaled feet. But the people that he wanted to protect, the people that he wanted to get out of there, the woman that he fell in love with, he couldn't do anything for them. They all died. And I think something that we have to remember here is Conan is 16 years old. This is not 25-year-old Conan. This is not 30-year-old Conan. This is not Conan who's been walking the earth for a decade and has a lot of experience under his belt. This is a 16-year-old boy. This is a boy who has left his homeland for the first time, has very little experience under his belt. He knows how to kill and he knows how to fight. He seems to have a natural inclination for leadership and strategy, but he hasn't been outside of Sumeria long enough to really let that evolve into anything other than just something that kind of comes naturally to him. And so I feel like, I mean, I know that some folks have read this and are kind of on the fence with it. Great issue, but why did it have to end on such a downer? Why did Conan have to fail? And I think Conan did have to fail here. I think he needed to. This, I think as part of his storyline, he needed to have a big loss here because this is a just a huge learning moment for him as a 16-year-old boy. And I think that we're going to see slightly different Conan going forward, one who might be a bit more cautious, or one who maybe will start hacking and slashing first and asking questions later. You know, I don't know. It'll be interesting to see what we get coming out of the story. But those were my favorite bits. And that's it, folks. I have nothing left to say about Conan number 6 from Dark Horse Comics.
Everybody out.
Next week, we get into the first of the final two Dark Horse issues that weren't originally going to be part of this run of episodes, but I recently committed to doing them, and so next week, we're going to be looking at Conan number 7 from August of 2004, Blood for Blood, because yeah, we got to see what Conan's going to do next. We got to see how it's going to tie in to the end of issue 6. You know, who's Conan looking for? Who put all this into motion? Who needs to die? And yeah, like I said, I think we all know who it is, but if not, well, come back next week and find out. But hey, if you don't want to wait until next week, second level members of the super secret Steeven Society have access to Conan number 7 now. Join today by using the link in the show notes or go to secretsociety.hithercameconan.com. Second level memberships are just $2 a month and all episodes are ad free. Until then, folks, keep your swords close by, never stop treading them jeweled thrones, but most importantly, be nice to each other. Bye. I want to thank you for listening to this episode of Hither Came Conan. Questions and comments can be directed to feedback@hithercameconan.com or come join us on social media. Just look for @ConanPodcast on Twitter and Blue Sky and @HitherCameConan on Instagram, Threads, and Facebook. If you enjoyed today's episode, please rate the show over at Apple Podcasts or wherever you're listening. Donations to the show can be made at donate.hithercameconan.com or become a member of the Super Secret Steeven Society and get episodes early and ad-free. Join now using the link in the show notes or go to secretsociety.hithercameconan.com. Memberships start at just $1 a month.
Many wars and feuds did Conan fight. Honor and fear were heaped upon his name. In time, he became a king by his own hand. This story shall also be told.
Oompa loompa doopity doo. I got a Conan episode for you. Oompa loompa doompity dee. I just gotta make sure that I'm ready.
I need to make sure that my voice is good.
I don't want to try to write any more lyrics to that on the fly, but I gotta get my voice in the mood. I gotta get my brain in the mood. Which, of course, means that, you know, I gotta do a couple of these. All right.
Give this episode a try.
The narrow streets provide them with the advantage. Yeah,
sure.
Narrow streets providing an advantage
in the fight.
Plus, as Niord point. As the barbarian's memory goes back to that evening.
Oh my God, I think the furnace is about to kick on, which means I gotta wait because I didn't wait at the beginning to get the sound of the furnace in the background when I recorded the room. So now I gotta wait for the furnace to kick on and then record the room again for another 30 to 40 to 45, maybe even 60 seconds. It doesn't really need to be that long, but just in case I forgot that it happened, I want that part of the episode to stick out to me. A big, long bit of silence. Here goes the furnace. I have finished recording the room. I honestly don't know why I have that furnace on. It's actually getting quite warm in here because it's warming up outside. So I think I'm just going to go ahead and get up and turn the furnace on.
Okay, so the furnace is off. Well, the thermostat has been turned down. And as I sit here waiting for the furnace, I'm thinking thermostat and furnace at the same time. Oh, there, it just went off. Regardless, I got some water. I'm going to drink some water and eat some Ritz Bits crackers really fast. Okay? Ritz Bits crackers, the kind with the cheese. I got these Ritz Bits the other day and I sang a little song in which made my wife shake her head at me. I got some Ritz Bits. They got the cheese in them, girl, and you know they're gonna be really good. Okay, let's get back to it. Conan, still climbing the long and winding dolphin stair, suddenly finds himself high above the battle, watching in horror as below The undermages fire beams of light from their magic jewels, taking out the men of Asgard, dropping them to the stone. Conan still climbing the long and winding Conan still climbing the long and winding dolphin stair. That sounds so stupid, doesn't it? The dolphin stare. But that's what it says in the fucking comic. Not stare as in, I'm giving you the dolphin stare. The stare of the dolphin as I look into your eyes. That's, no, it's S-T-A-R, but saying it out loud sounds stupid in my brain. Conan, still climbing the long and winding dolphin stair, suddenly finds himself high above the battle. And as he watches in horror, below the undermages... And he watches in horror as below, the undermages firing beams of brings of beans and baked beans. This is a fucking paragraph. Dumb shithead fucker. Good God almighty, what's going on today? Oh, that was quite nice.
I just don't think I can move through life knowing that a guy named Steven did this to me.
How could you let this happen, Steven?
Your podcast sucks.
Enough talk.